Great. I took a tactical pause to get out here because the awesome crew back here really is running a tight show. I'm very used to walking wherever I want, and the young lady over there said no. But how about a round of applause for them, because really, it's spectacular. So Julie mentioned that she was, we met a while ago, and I want to talk about that specifically in a moment. Because her and Aaron were key parts to our success. But also, as she gave accolades to me, it really wasn't about me. It was the great team that we assembled, several people in this audience that I know, the 100 people from the Department of Defense. But it was the teamwork with industry, academia, and the government that really made us successful. And Palantir, I'm going to just self-report, the reason why I'm here is they were such a great teammate. And Julie and Aaron, two people that many people know in this room, were a big part of that. And I'm going to walk my way through that in a moment. Because I just enjoyed what they did. And I wouldn't be here if that wasn't a part of their persona. And I'll articulate that in a little bit. So, I spent 40 years in the Army. I did 2 in the National Guard while I was finishing college, and I did 38 years of active duty. I started out as an infantry officer and begrudgingly went to become a logistics officer. Turned out, very lucky move for me. I was an average infantry officer. I was a great logistician, my self-reporting. but truthfully, I think, you know, results at the end of the day validate my comment. So it was the best thing that ever happened to me. My love was running through the woods and doing the maneuver and attacking. The hardest thing I ever did was learn how to become a logistician, where data is so, so important. But I know you can understand this. In the last 40 years, data hasn't been as prevalent as we might think it is, because now there's so much of it. Back in those days, it really wasn't a lot, or we didn't know how to obtain it, or we obtained it in very draconian ways, right? And we were all there. I remember sitting in Somalia as a young captain, maybe 7, 8 years in the Army. I got there the night before. The next day, we're in this firefight, and somebody comes and gets me and says, "Hey, sir, the Pentagon's on the phone for you." I said, "For me? I'm Captain Perna." "Yeah, they asked for you by name." So I get on the phone as Brigadier General. "Hey, I need you to tell me the status of the equipment in Somalia." I mean, literally, you could hear rifle bullets going, right? And so I said, "Hey, nope, no excuses, answer the question." I said, "Okay." And I rattled off about 10 pieces of equipment and the readiness rates. The guy sitting next to me says, "Sir, how'd you do that? You didn't even see a piece of paper." I said, "Hey, you know what? He has no clue." And I know I was close enough, right? To fast forward, right, to here we are in Operation Warp Speed, and I have access to all the information I might need. And this is so crucial, okay? This is really a crucial point, because when we took over in Operation Warp Speed, I want you to think about this. We had no structure of people. We had no flow of money. We had no playbook on how to solve this problem. None of those things, right? I, like many people in this room, have been pacing the floor at night watching the news saying, "What are we doing? It doesn't look like there's a plan. It looks like there's a lot of conversation and a lot of, well, let's just leave it at that." And I was terrifically unhappy. So about a month before I was supposed to retire, I get this phone call from General Milley, the chairman of the Joint Chiefs. It's a Saturday morning. I'm in doing reports. It's the chairman. And quite frankly, you know, I don't know how many of you have had a phone call from the chairman, but when I turned over my phone and I saw General Milley, I said, "Crap." this is not going to be a good, hey, you're doing great conversation, right? And so what it turns out was, he says, hey, look, we're putting this team together, and we want you to be on the team. I said, look, I don't know anything about any of this stuff. He goes, no, but you're the best logistician I know, and we need you to set up the distribution. Take time, think about it, and let me know. Within a nanosecond, I said, I'm in. And why did I say I was in? One, I was sitting on the sideline bitching and moaning, so shame on me. Two, I personally believed, whether you want to take vaccines or not, I personally believed it was a major thing to do to really save the nation. I believed that the nation was at risk. I believed it was a national security risk. Hundreds of thousands, millions of people around the world were dying. And infrastructure, in my view, had great potential for catastrophe, right? Networks, trucking, rail, airlines, small businesses, large businesses. I personally believed that COVID was a national security risk. And so I felt morally and ethically obligated to take on this responsibility. With that said, like I said, there wasn't much to that. That was a Saturday morning. I left for the Pentagon on Monday. I spent the week working through, let's define the purpose of our mission, right? So I can get that straight, because I think that is so important. And then we started putting people together. On May 18th, I was in the Rose Garden. The morning, May 19th, I want you to picture this. I was sitting with myself and three Army colonels. That was all there was, myself and three Army colonels. And we were going down the list of what we needed. Number one on my list was I needed to see myself. I can't see myself. The best I could understand in this world was that it was so compartmentalized, the information, that there was no way to really truly make decisions. And anything you were hearing daily in the news or media was based on some tidbit that somebody mentioned in a room and they ran with it. But there was no collecting of information. There was no collaboration. There was no synchronization and integration of information. Really, really important, right? Because if you want to do something, you have to be able to see yourself. If you can't see yourself, there is no way you know where you're at, where you're going to be, and what you have to do, all right? And so that was my number one requirement. Now, I'm going to tell you the story about meeting Julie and Aaron, but first, I do want to start off with some good things that occurred, right? We had clear, concise purpose, safe and effective vaccines for the American people. Took a little work to get that, but after a week of walking the Pentagon, we nailed that down. Two, we had absolute priority and resources. Many people in this room don't have that in their life, right? You're doing things on limited resources, and sometimes you get priority, sometimes you don't, but you got to figure out how to get it done. I want to tell you, I had absolute priority and resources. And just for the record, because I'm 100% apolitical, I got it from both White Houses. The Department of Defense team was the only team that transitioned from President Trump to President Biden. Both White Houses gave me absolute priority and resources, period. The third thing we had was unity of effort. This is so important. I mentioned, right, the role of academia, the role of industry, the role of government. It was because of this team effort that we were able to accomplish our mission. There was no one entity that did more than the other. Everybody checked their egos at the door. We had one purpose, safe and effective vaccines for the American people, right? And this is really important to understand. All right, so Saturday morning, I say, go figure out how to see myself. We go through the bureaucracy of the government, right? As much as there was an emergency, there's still a bureaucracy there. And we're trying to hire somebody to come in and help us see ourselves because we don't have the capability and the capacity. I've tried this numerous times. I tried to fix the Army supply chain. I tried to fix Army housing. I tried to fix munitions deployment. It's not new, right? And we had to do it without really truly seeing ourselves. We had piecemeals of success. So I was determined to be able to see ourselves. The only way we were going to bend the laws of physics, which is what we had to do, without compromising the safety and the effectiveness of the vaccine, was we had to cheat, right? We had to cheat in what we were going to do, how we were going to move it, when we were going to move it, you know, where it was going to go, etc. And I used the word cheat in taking advantage of the situation. And that was only going to happen if I got the right information. So starting on Monday through about Friday, I had this line of organizations coming in to see me about telling me how they're going to solve our problem, right? How they're going to do this and they're going to do that. I had one simple question for them. I said, tell me your purpose in our mission. And they would spend, I gave them all an hour. And they would spend 59 minutes explaining to me what they were going to do and how they were going to do it, right? And it was just excruciating. I just need you to know, sitting on my desk at home, I still have the abacus my father gave me when I was in sixth grade. So I want you to leap, look at me, think about I'm using an abacus, and now I got all this intellectual capacity coming in and telling me what they're going to do and how they're going to do it. You know what they couldn't answer? Was purpose. And then here comes Julie Bush and Aaron. I asked them the same question. They said, well, sir, what we're going to do is our purpose is to provide you with all the information you need along all your nodes rapidly so that you can make the best decisions, understanding what risk is, and you can keep things moving. I said, great, you're hired. It was that simple, right? It was that simple to how we're moving forward. When I got up on the whiteboard and I defined the problem for them after that conversation, right, I said, I don't have a lot of trust and confidence. I've been down this road, right? You might not have been the group I picked if it wasn't for what you said to me. But I am convinced because you're focused on the purpose, you're going to get this done. And I want to see these nodes, and I wrote them down. I said, I need to see the supply chain for manufacturing. I need to see manufacturing. I need to see manufacturing in volume and manufacturing down to the vials. I need to see all the manufacturing that's going to enable us, whether it's syringes and needles, whether it's consumables like plastic bags and tubes we need to manufacture the vaccine, or whether it was vials. We did not have enough vials in the United States of America for 600 million doses of vaccine. At the time, we thought 300 million, and the math showed us we didn't have enough. You know how I knew that? Because these guys showed me it, right? Because of their relationships and how they put it together for me. Phone call after I got that little screen update, holy crap, was right to an industry partner, and they said, you're right, we can't do that much, but if you call us back tomorrow, we'll have a plan. And we helped them with that plan, and we had enough vials, right, if that makes sense. I needed to know every distribution node in the United States of America. The plan briefed to me for distribution was, sir, we're going to deliver it to one spot in every state, and every state won't be able to get it simultaneously. We'll do like five states, and then a week later we'll do five more states, and then a week later we'll do five more states, and we'll drop it in the middle, and they'll move it around, you know, blah, blah, blah. I said, okay, everybody out. I said, it's unacceptable. I said, what we're going to do is we're going to deliver vaccines, and I said, this is my fault. I haven't described it right. And so I got up and described it. I said, we're going to deliver vaccines the day after they're approved, 24 hours. We're going to deliver it simultaneously around the nation. Everybody's going to get it at the same time to the proportional relationship of their population, right? I don't care what color their state is. I don't care who calls me the most. I don't care. This is how it's going to happen. It's going to go out to the Pacific territories. It's going to go to Alaska. It's going to go to Maine. It's going to go to Puerto Rico. And it's going to go to every state in the nation, to include several federal agencies as well as several major cities. And it's going to happen in 24 hours. And not only is that going to happen, but it's going to happen every freaking week until we're done. And every week, the vaccine is going to exponentially increase, because we're going to produce 5 million, next week it'll be 10 million, then it'll be 20 million, then it'll be 30 million, 50 million, you understand? And that's how we're going to do this. Well, General, we can't see all that, right? A couple people in the back room, Aaron Jaffe, right? Sir, I heard the whole conversation. We can do that. We can bring this in. We can connect all that for you. We'll show your distribution nodes. What we need is access to this information and that information. And it was 50 phone calls later, the governors, bunch of lawyers, quite frankly, and then they did it. And I could see everything, right? I could see everything that I needed to see. Then I said, okay, well, that's really nice. I could see everything. Now I want to track the administration of how many vaccine doses were going into arms. You know, we can't do that. Probably for all the right reasons. We don't want to interfere personal business of people. We want to make sure that, you know, vaccines are a personal choice. I can't tell you how many airplanes I get on and somebody recognizes me. Oh, I didn't take it. I didn't take the vaccine. Okay. All right, hey, let me put my headphones back on. It's a personal choice, okay? It's your personal choice. It's your body. That was not my mission, to make people take the vaccine. My mission was to understand where the vaccine was in production, in delivery, and in administration, so I could report accordingly. You know how brutally hard that was? Because the plan or the thought process was we were going to do vaccines in stadiums. We were going to send the vaccine in stadiums, and then people were going to get bussed in and drive in and, you know, get their shots. How many people have been to a football game in their lifetime here, right? I mean, it's impossible to park, right, and get in there, never mind have to use the bathroom and et cetera, et cetera. And then how are we going to get people back in there, you know, 2 weeks later to take the second shot, right? It was absurd thought process. It was a thought process of, I've never been in charge of anything that has to do with delivering ammo or food or fuel to the foxhole, right? I'm just going to draw this big picture. Well, our vision was that we were going to go from this one central spot in every state, right, like the way they do other things, and we were going to deliver, we were going to pilferate everything, right? When we started the vaccine on or about 15 December, distributing it, we had over 70,000 locations set up, 70,000. There's over 100,000 now. We had to collect the data, we had to connect them, and it was Palantir that put that together for me, that helped me see myself, and I could see where every drop of vaccine was at every moment of the day. I can't tell you, I will tell you, I could recognize a governor's voice, because they'd be calling my house at 10, 11, 12 o'clock at night, or 4 in the morning, depending on where they were. The territories were calling me, governors were calling me, city mayors were calling me, the Senate was calling me, right? I could tell who it was that was talking to me, because it was my phone, but I didn't have a number, or I mean, I didn't have a name, by their voice. That's how often I got these calls. And they used to say things like, General, I don't have enough vaccine. General, I need more vaccine. General, I didn't get my shipments. And I'd say, okay, let's talk about this for a moment, right? Let's talk about where your vaccine are. I said, are you in your building? And they'd say, yeah, I'm in my building. I said, okay, good, Governor. Walk down the hallway to room 102. Well, what's in room 102? I said, you'll find a contractor down there from Palantir, right? And I'm going to get on the screen, and I'm going to drive the mouse, and I am going to answer your questions. You just ask me your questions, and I will sit on the phone, and I'll show you. And I popped up in my quarters the visualization of what he or she was seeing in their headquarters. And I said, okay, you said you don't have enough vaccine. It shows that you just got a delivery and you have 700,000 doses. Oh, no, General, that's not true. Oh, yes, it is. Go get your chief of staff. Go get somebody. I'm telling you, I am 100% accurate. General, I need more. Okay, well, next week I'm going to deliver twice as much to you. You'll have 1.4 million on top of the 700,000. And I was able to do that. You understand how important that was to cut the riffraff out? General, I hear that this state here is getting more than I'm getting. Nope. Here's the math. Here's what everybody's getting. I show the screen. Here's what you got. It was 100% visibility for everybody that was involved in the vaccine, right? This was so important to our success, right? There was a time, I don't know if some people remember this, but we started delivering the vaccine on 15 December. Somewhere around 15 January, we'd done about 4 weeks. It was about 15 million doses out in the country, maybe 20 million, and a major snowstorm hit the Midwest. Right? You can't make this crap up. The major snowstorm has shut down the Midwest. Now, I couldn't move one distribution truck. Right? Governors were bringing in the National Guard to move things locally. But I couldn't get distribution out. It was physically impossible. And we knew that, right? Because of the amount of snow, etc. Because I could see myself, I knew what was the supply chain. I knew the manufacturing. I knew what was distributed, right? Because we got ahead of the storm. I knew what I was getting in, which was going to be double the amount that we distributed so far. I was able to spin courses of action to help me deliver the vaccine. And when I say I mean the royal I of the team enabled by Tiberius, the Palantir product that we used. Okay? We not only delivered the vaccine that we were supposed to deliver that week when the snowstorm hit, we delivered the double of the next rotation. So we paused, but we didn't fail. And because I could see myself, because I had options that I could run based on the data, right? Because I understood the risk, remember what the team told me? Sir, we're going to give you all the data you need so that you can assess, determine risk, and make decisions rapidly. That's what we were able to do. And I cannot tell you how many times that played out week after week after week on things that we needed to do, whether it was delivering vaccines to the territories and figuring out where we were going to put dry ice, where we were going to put kits, needles, and syringes, right? Or was it managing the supply chain because we were running six different vaccines simultaneously and we had to manufacture them? We had to understand where all the product was at a moment's notice so that one company didn't get more than the other, right? So that we had fair and equitable, right? So that all the vaccines had the potential to be successful, right? Because why? The purpose was safe and effective vaccines for the American people. My heart, my belief, it was a national security problem, right? We couldn't fail. Failure was not an option, right? But again, remember what I told you. Didn't have any people, didn't have any money, didn't have any structure, didn't have any playbook, right? But the effort, the unity of effort, the priority of funding and resources, the sole purpose and the team approach to things is why we were successful. Right? And so in that light, though, we wanted to make sure we set up the situation for our success to go past us. We needed this to be routine. It couldn't be something that we just did. Right? My belief was, and I'll self-report, I am the farthest thing from a scientist that exists. Right? I'm a strict business major who turned into a logistician. Right? Right. I can still remember my biology teachers. He had to tell me, hey, I got to give you a D. It's a good thing I could play football. Anyway, my point to that was I think personally that this is not something we're done with. It's not a one and done. So my premise to the team was you got to set up repeatable things to move into the future, right? So that they happen on their own. Understanding that we can't stand up an entire headquarters that does nothing for 100 years or 50 years or 10 years, right? We needed the capability and the capacity to come up right away. The key was, how do I manage capability, capacity? How do I create capability and capacity without overwhelming a resource requirement, right? What was I going to do that I wasn't doing, and what did I need to do that I'm not doing, right, is the simple leadership approach. If I got called into the White House today and said, hey, what would be the one thing, General, that you would tell us to do for anything in the future with a pandemic, I say, see, can you see yourself? Do you have the capability and the capacity to see yourself from end to end? Because we did that. We put it together. It wasn't there to begin with. It's there now. And if you're not on the phone, right, getting this in place, then shame on you. Because it's here, and it exists, and it's workable. And every day since the first day we put it in place, it is guiding. It is, well, that's a great word. Right? Right out of New Jersey, got stuck in my New Jersey throat. Holy crap. And this is being recorded, I think. So it has improved exponentially every day since. There is no of this, right? Well, that was good enough. It was good enough for what I needed to make decisions for, but now it's become exponentially better. And it's helping us see things that we never knew were possible. It's helping us manage our resources from the beginning to the end, not only for effectiveness, but for efficiency. Okay? We want to drive down medical prices in this country, you know, medicines, hospitalization drills. We need to be able to see ourselves. This capability is what we need to do. It's not a declarative, make things lower. It's about the execution to ensure effectiveness and efficiency, right? What are you doing that you're not doing? What do you need to do that you should be or that you should be doing? Okay, how is it possible that we are doing organ donor replacements, right? My words, on an Excel spreadsheet and a yellow pad. We ought to be personally and professionally embarrassed as a nation, right? Now, I'm over-exaggerating it, but I'm not too far off. Why haven't we automated the capability and the capacity of that program alone? And I take it personally because my father needed something and it never came to fruition. But how are we not doing that? Does it really take a crisis to solve these things? Information is going to be the king. Those who have it, those who understand it, those who are willing to make decisions with it are going to be successful, right? The information alone is not what you need. What you need is the ability to have the information, the ability to look at the information, the ability to make decisions off the information based on the risk and the effects that you want, right? Here's what I had in my 100-man staff. Every single person had access to that information. The governors had access to it. The White House had access to it. The leaders of the in between had access to it. You know what my 100 people were empowered to do? Make decisions without running into my office. They understood their purpose. They understood their objectives. They understood what needed to be done. They understood what was going to happen if we weren't successful. Because they had the data, they trained how to find the data, they trained on how to make decisions on the data, they were making decisions without coming into my office. That was the brilliance of our success, right? I'm just going to share that with you. It does not, my limited experience, both inside the Department of Defense and outside in commercial industry, that decision-making process does not exist. I'm a harsh critic of it. It needs to be if we want to be successful in the things in our future, right? We talk about the readiness of the nation for a potential whatever, whether it's in Europe or in the Pacific or simultaneously. Who do you think is going to win that fight? You know what has to happen to get that fight going? We have to energize the industrial base. Every mode of transportation is going to have to occur. We're going to have to be physically executing in two opposite parts of the world. We're going to have to sustain it tactically, operationally, and logistically. Can we get the production out of industry? Can we move it operationally across two vast oceans? Can we deliver it to a foxhole in time for somebody to shoot somebody? You know how difficult that is? We talk about it like it's just going to happen. It's not going to just happen. You know how it's going to happen? The people that can see themselves, the people that can make decisions off that information, the people who can share that information simultaneously with partners, up and down, left and right, that's who's going to be successful. Okay? That is who's going to be successful. Now, the last thing I want to just tell you reinforce this. Because I heard some chatter today, and there's pockets of, you know, individual success. Christine Fox, if nobody knows Christine Fox, I personally think she is a national treasure and one of the brilliant minds of our future. And I'm just grateful that she's still serving both publicly and privately to help do things. But I found that conversation really intriguing. Right, because I personally think, and I applaud the young lady that was up here leading it for us, I personally think we're about 20 years behind. That's just my personal opinion. And if we don't really kind of get things going, and if we don't knock down the bureaucracy to this decision making, but more importantly, if we don't figure out how to start sharing this type of capability and capacity and information to get these things done, we are not going to be successful. All right, it's really, really simple. Right? We cannot win World War III without all the combined services in the Department of Defense, the brilliance of academia, and the freaking genius of commercial industry. Right? That's how we're going to win World War III. Right? But we got to open up the left and right limits to get there. If that does not happen, we're going to be in deep trouble. So I would say to you, that we can do anything as long as we're willing to do it together, right? As long as we're willing to not worry about who gets the credit. What I really enjoyed about my time in OWS is we came to work, we collaborated together, right? We had a sense of purpose. We were going to get it done. It didn't take a lot of ego. It took talented people working together to get it done. And that's what I would credit us, that success. I would tell you there was a couple awkward moments. Four-star generals really don't have a trouble firing people. But when you get people volunteering to be a part of something, it's hard to fire people. But I had one red line. If ego got in front of what was happening, you were gone. And you departed very rapidly. And I'm the person who did it. I was the only one allowed to do it. Nobody else was allowed to say goodbye to anybody. So if they got a tap on the shoulder and said, go see General Perna, that usually was kind of, you know, like, thanks, see you later. I would not allow ego to be a part of what we were doing. And I really didn't care. I didn't care who you were, who you thought you were, you know, in your own little world, whether you were a CEO, whether you were a general, whether you were, some scientist that's in charge of something. I was mildly interested in all that. Really, for me, it was about the information I had in front of me, why things weren't happening, and let's get over it, ready to go. And I did have one or two people, maybe three, think that they understood something more than what I was doing. The bluff is, right, it can be done. The quote that you see here on the screen is by William Knudsen. He worked for Ford and GM. Right, and he was brought in by President Roosevelt in 1937, I think, to start setting up the industrial base to be prepared to fight World War II. He started in 37. He made him a three-star general. He was a business genius. It wasn't until 41 that we started manufacturing things. Why? Because industry only does what they're paid for. It's good part of industry. But they only do what they're paid for. Right? In 41, we started paying. It wasn't until 43 that we had enough planes and tanks and ammo and fuel to really get into World War II, right? 2 years later, right? It was less than 18 months later that we won the war. I want you to think about that. What did Knudsen have? He had the genius of how to put all that together. He was stifled because he didn't have the flow of information that we have today. Today, there is no reason why we shouldn't be able to come together with all the information we need and make decisions rapidly to cheat that timeline. We won't be able to wait 18 months if it's World War III. With that, thanks for your time. I think we're going to pause.
Thank you so much, General Perna.